Well, today in this class we can discuss about the concept of set theory. So that is very useful in discrete mathematics. That is, we can use the certain type of things which we required in a discrete mathematics concept regarding the set theory. So what is a set? A set is an unordered collection of unique objects. So suppose we can give set A, in which we can write all the number of vowels like that A, E, I, O, U. So it is nothing but a set in which contain the certain type of elements. So set can be represented in their different way. One, the set name should be always represented in the capital letter, either capital A, B, Z, C, D up to. So a small case letter to indicate the element of the set. So the set is a fundamental discrete structure, and for basis of more complex discrete structure like graph. So in a graph, we can use the different type of vertices and different type of edges which we have to represent in the form of set. So usually we can denote the uppercase letter which we represent in the form of set. So the set name always represent in the form of A, B, C and like that. So that is indicate set, and element of set we can represent in a small case letter. So here X is a member of A. So that symbol is indicate for the X is a member of A. If suppose X is not a member of A, then we can simply write X, it is not a member of A. So that is the set A, and it is a member of set X is a member of A, then we can represent in the mathematical notation X is a member of A, and if it is not a member of A, then we can simply, you can cross this not member, X is not a member of A. So there is a different way to we can represent the term of sets. So in the set we can represent either in the conventional notation or in the mathematical notation. So here we can give a list of element 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It is represented as a set A. So we can give in the form of verbal description, we can also return A equal to integer X, such that X is lies in between greater than equal to 1 and less than equal to 6. Similar, we can write, suppose another example we can take, X, A is a set which can contain the even number like 2, 4, 6, 8 and so on. So we can represent in the form of mathematical notation, we can write X such that X is even and X is greater than 0. So there are two ways in which we can represent the element of set. One is, it is list of elements separated by the commas and write within a curly braces. And another way to represent the set, it is the mathematical notation, is the X such that X is even and the value is greater than 0. So greater than 0, the even value is, it will be start from 2, 4, 6, 8 and so on. So that is the way of describing the sets. Now there are two special sets we are using. One is the empty set. If a set which can contain no element, it is indicated for the empty set, and empty set it is represented with the help of phi symbol. And the another set which is called as a universal set, this is a set for all elements currently under consideration, and it is symbolized by the U, that is indicated for the universal set. So now, if two sets A and B are equal, if they contain the same element, as we can told, the definition of set, it is an unordered collection of distinct objects which is called as a set. So the two sets which both are equal, we can say A equal to B, if we can contain the number of element in A equal to 2, 3, 5, 7. Now, here we can arrange in a different way, that is 3, 2, 7, 5, because set is an unordered collection of distinct objects. So both are equal. Suppose we can write A equal to this one and B equal to 7537, but both 7532, but we can write A equal to B because they can contain same number of element, but the order may be different. So the two set A and B are equal if they contain same element. So here in this example we can say, because the set are unordered but the number of element are same, another 2, 3, 5, 7 and equal to 2, 2, 3, 5, 3, 7. The meaning is that if the element contain multiple occurrence of same element occurring, same element can be occur more than once time. So because a set contain a unique element, because the element is same, if it is a 2 can contain 2 time, 3 time, but the no one new element can be occur, so that's why we can also say these both are equal. And if 2, 3, 5, 7 which not equal to 2, 3, because 7 and 5 are missing elements. So in that case we can say these are not equal. So the in general we can say if the two sets are equal, if they contain same number of element and the order does not matter. And if suppose a number of same element can be occur n number of times, and so it is also we can say the both elements are equal. So next is the cell builder notation. In a set builder notation, we can write one notation, O is the output equal to X, such that X is a member of Z. So before we can start to the member of Z, we can come to the certain notation if I have to require, so which is very useful. N, we can use the capital term N, it is a set of natural numbers. Now set, it is a set of integer, we can represent with the Z. Now R, it is indicate for the set of real number. C, it is a set of complex number. So and Q, it is a set of rational number. So these are the terms we are using to solving the problem of set theory. So generally we are using the notation N, it is a set of natural number. The Z, it is a set of integer. The set of integer, it will also contains negative integer value as well as positive integer value. Set of real number, it is a set of complex A plus iota B, and it is a set of rational number we are using, which is indicate for the Q. So now we can come to the point of the value which we have to consider the problem, which is the set builder notation. X is a member of Z, and we know that the Z is a set of integer which can consist negative as well as positive value. It is used the conjunction X equal to 2k for some k is a member of Z. So what we want to indicate with this statement, we know that this is a X is a member of Z, it is indicate for the integer, and X must be a even. Why it is even? Because X equal to 2k. So it will be read as a, it is a set of contain all X such that X is an integer and X is a even. Because it is indicate for the set of integer value, and also X equal to 2k, it is indicate for the even integer value. So a set is defined in intension when you give its self-builder notation. So the intention, the self-builder notation means X such that X is a member of Z, conjunction X lies in between the 0 to 8 and X equal to 2k. The meaning is that first is X equal to 2k means it is an even number. X lies between 0 to 8, that is it can contain the number in between, lies between the 0 to 8. So 0 to 8, what the even number should be generate? 0, 2, 4, 6 and 8. So this is nothing but the output. So that output we can represent in the mathematical equation form, that is called the intension notation. And I said it defined in the extension when we enumerated all the element which is separated by the comma. So it is nothing but output is like that 0, 2, 4, 6, 8. So in both the way we can represent in the form of self-written notation either in the intension or in the extension form. Now, a set has no element is called as an empty set. As we can told earlier, there is a two type of notation we can use. Empty set is indicated by the phi and the universal set is indicated from the U. So a set that has only one element, it is called as a singleton set. For example, we can write a curly braces, we can write a A. So that is indicated within a bracket, it is called as a singleton set. But without curly braces, we can write simply A, it is called as an element of the set A. So, now another term we want to say, the empty set have what type of, if suppose we can write here, phi is not equal to a set of phi. Why means, the left hand side is the empty set, that is a phi. And the right hand side of the singleton set, and the set containing a set. So, the meaning is that the empty set only contains one set. But if suppose we can say what is the power set of this one, that we have to detail description in the later on. So, it is contained the 2 to the power n number of sets. So, here we can simply say the phi is not equal to the curly braces of the phi. Now, the next point which we want to discuss, that is the membership relationships. A set A is said to be a subset of set B, and we write in the form of A is a subset of B. If and only if every element of the A contain element of the B. So, it is nothing but we can write in the mathematical form, it is biconditional. For all of x, x is a member of A implies x is a member of B. So every element of set A must be element of B should be included. So that's why we can say A is a subset of B. Now we can say what is a proper subset of A is a subset of B. So here we can take even example A equal to we can take element 1 comma 3. Now B we can take 1, 2, 3. And now C set we can take 3, 2 and 1. Now, what we want to say, it is the A, B, C, there are three sets and we want to justify whether A is a subset of B, A is a subset of C or A is a proper subset of C or A is a not proper subset of C. So, we can say A is a subset of C, that is every element of A, if every element of A is also in element of B. In element of A, we can consist to element 1 of 3, which is also consist in element of C. So that's why we can say A is a subset of C. We can also say A is a subset of B because every element of A must contain in every element of B. So that is the, we can say a subset A is a subset of B. So, in the definition, we can write the notation A is a subset of B. So, X is a member of A implies that X is a member of B. All the members of A are also the member of B. The notation for the subset is very similar to the notation less than or equal to, and means in terms that included or it is equal to. So, here we can also write B and C, B is a subset of C. Because every element of B, which also contains the element of C. So we can say B is a subset of C. Now, we can come to the point, what is the difference between a subset and a proper subset? So now, the proper subset we can, the meaning is that proper subset we can write here, the A is a proper subset of B. The meaning is that A is a proper subset of B if all the members of A are also the member of B, but in addition there exists at least one element C. That is, C is a member of B, but C is not a member of A. So that is called as a proper subset of A is a proper subset of B. We can take an example. A equal to, just we can take 1 comma 3 and B we can take 1, 2 and 3. Now, here we can write A is a subset of B, it is right. Now, A is, we can say A is a proper subset of B. The meaning is that if can say that ki all the members of A, A contain only two members, all the members of A are also the member of B, but in addition there exists at least one element C that is member of B. That is, we can say it is 2 is a member of B, but 2 is not a member of A. So we can say A is proper subset of B. Here we can take another example C. C is, we can take 3, 2, 1. So now B is a subset of C, but we cannot say B is a proper subset of C, because in the B we can contain 3 element 1, 2, 3. In C we can also contain the 3 element 3, 2, 1. But when we can say a proper subset of C, that list at least one element C which is belonging to B, which is not belonging to A, when we can say A is a proper subset of B. Now the next things we can discuss in the set theory, that is Venn diagram. So Venn diagram is nothing but a topological area to extend the sets and in a pictorial representation of the set theory. So what is the Venn diagram? First we can discuss about the Venn diagram. So here in a Venn diagram we can say that is a set A and it is a set B, and it is, we can call, universal sets. So now all the, we can contain all the parts of A and B, it is called as A union B. Either we can contain the element of A or we can contain the element of B. If we want to find the A intersection B, then we can write it is A set, it is a B set, and this shaded portion, this is indicate for the A intersection B. The A intersection B indicate it is the element which must contain either A and B. If suppose we want to find the A complement, it is the set A, it is universal set, and these are the portion which we call as A to the power C, that is A complement. Now if we can say that two sets are disjoint, then we can say these are the two set A and B, and it is a universal, we can say both are the disjoint. Now another set we can represent, which is called, it is a B, it is A, and it is a universal. So we can say A is a subset of B. So these are the way in which we can represent the set theory. We can represent in the form of pictorial representation, we can use the concept of Venn diagram. So with the Venn diagram, we can also check the validity of the argument. Whether the argument is valid or not, we can check with the help of Venn diagram. Certain theorem we can also prove with the help of Venn diagram. So now, this is the concept about the Venn diagram. Now, a Venn diagram can be used to determine whether or not an argument is valid. So as we can told, to check the validity of the argument, we can also use the concept of Venn diagram. So here one problem in which we can more clarify about the what is the purpose of Venn diagram. Show the following argument is valid. So there is three premises are given, S1, S2, S3 are the premises, and the conclusion is S. So premises are there, the my suspense are only things I have that made of things. S2 statement is, I find all your presents very useful, And as to use none of my suspense is the slightest use. So finally, conclusion is your presents to me are not made of tin. So we can solve this problem based on the Venn diagram. So here we can just solve the problem of this one. First one, they can say, statement one says, my suspense are only things and I have that made of tin. So that is a tin object, and that tin object, it is my suspense are only things. So these are the suspense. So suspense are only things, and that is made of tins. Now, the next point is, it is the S3 statement, none of my suspense is the slightest use. So we can take this one, the another disk in which we can say the my suspense is of the slightest use. None of my suspense is the slightest use. So what we can take? We can take it is the useful things, and I find a statement 2, I find all your present very useful. So we can take useful things under that the present is useful. So now this is the statement 3, all the statement 1, statement 2 and statement 3 we can represent in the form of Venn diagram, and conclusion is that your present to me are not made of tin. So this is the present to me are not made of tin, because tin object and present both are disjoint. Both are disjoint means they are not interrelated. So we can say your present to me are not made of tin. The statement is valid. So we can say statement, the conclusion statement is valid because both object are disjoint. So that's why we can say your present to me are not made of tin. It is the valid argument. So now next the things is that we can discuss, that is the different type of set operations. So we can perform the union operation, intersection operation, complement operation, symmetric difference operations, and union generalization, intersection generalization. So the arithmetical operation can be used on pair of number to give us a new numbers. Similarly, set operator exists and act on a two set to give us a new sets. So that's the things we have to discuss one by one: the union operation, intersection operation, set difference, set complement, generalized union and generalized intersection, and the symmetric difference. So now first we can discuss about the union operation. The union of two sets A and B is a set that contain the all element in A and B or both. It is just like as a Venn diagram of this union operation. It is the a set A and it is a set B. It is universal. So all the element which can consist either in A or B or both, we can call as a A union B. So A union B we can write in such a way that X, such that X is a member of A, or we can say X is a member of B. So when we can use this symbol OR, we can say it is nothing but OR disjection. We can say it is type of logical OR. So we can say this union operation will be treated as a logical OR. Now the another is the intersection. The intersection operation we can represent in the Venn diagram with this one, it is A, B, universal, and this intersect part, this is shaded line, it is indicate for the A intersection B. And A intersection B, we can define in a mathematical notation X such that X is a member of A, conjunction or and X is a member of B. It is similar to the logical AND. So the intersection of the two set A and B is the set that contain all elements that are element of both A and B, that is the intersect part. That is the part which we can say A intersection B, and we can write in such a way that A intersection B equal to X such that X is a member of A and X is a member of B, which is equivalent to the logical AND operation. So now, if the two sets are disjoint, now here we can one by one we can define with the help of Venn diagram. If the two sets are said to be disjoint, if the intersection is the empty set, if the two sets are disjoint, that is nothing but if this is a set A, it is a set B. We can say A intersection B equal to phi. So that is the meaning. If the two sets are disjoint, then intersection of A intersection B is equal to null set or empty sets. So the difference of the another way, the difference of two sets A and B, which is denoted by the A slash B or A minus B, is the set containing those elements that are in A but not in B. So that is the way in which we can find out the difference between the A slash B. It is like that, it is the part of A, it is the B, and we can say that portion which is indicated for the A slash B. So is the contain those elements are in A but not in B. So now the complement of set A denoted by the A to the power C consists all elements not in A. That is called the A complement. It is just like the representation is, it is the set A, the universal set, and all the shaded line is indicated for the A to the power C. So all it is a universal set, it is A to the power C equal to X such that X is not a member of A. So outside of the member, it is universal set which can consist the part of A's complement. So given the universe U, it is the universe AB is the subset of U. Now the absolute complement of A is, we can say, U slash A, and the relative complement A with respect to B is called as a B slash A, because here we can find the absolute complement. But if suppose there is a two disjoint set A and B, then we can find the relative complement of A and B, that is called the B slash A. Now the next one is the union of collection of sets is the set of contain those elements that are member of at least one set of the collection, that is called as a generalized union operation. So in generalized union operation, we can start A of I equal to 1 to n, we can take the value of A1 union A2 up to AN. Similarly, when we find the value of intersection, generalized intersection operation, we can take I equal to 1 to n and AI, it is nothing but A1 intersection A2 intersection A3 up to intersection AN. So that is the form of generalized union and generalized intersection operation. So the intersection of collection of set, the set contains those elements that are members of every set in the collection. Now we can take the few examples in which we can identify what is the symmetric difference and what is the different type of operation. So we can take the one example, the value of set, universal set n equal to 1, 2, 3 up to n number of elements is existing. Now we can take the value a equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. Now b set value which can consist of 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And now the c set contains the value of 6, 7, 8, 9. And now the d set contains the value of set e, which can contain the value 2, 4, 6, 8 and so on. That is nothing but set of even number. So now we can find the value of a to the power c. What is the value of a to the power c? The a to the power c value we can consist all the elements which can consist in a, that is 1, 2, 3, 4. And there is a universal set, n is given the value of 1, 2, 3 and so on. So it is like that, just it is a universal set U, which is nothing but set of natural number which can contain 1, 2, 3 up to n number. The value of set A is 1, 2, 3, 4. The A complement, it is a set A, and these all are the parts we can contain A complement. So here A complement is nothing but other than value, other than set A. Other than set A means 5, 6, 7 and so on. What is the value of B to the power C? So the set which can contain the element of B, other than the set B element which is part of the complement of the B. So B's complement is nothing but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 is existing, 8, 9 and so on. So what is the value of C's complement? What is the value of complement of C? It is all the elements which are contained in C which cannot be included. So 6, 7, 8, 9 we can exclude, the value become 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and so on. So what is the value of e to the power c? The complement of e, e contains all even numbers. So it is, the complement is contained on odd number 1, 3, 5, 7, 9 and so on. So that is the part we can first find the complement value. Now the second point which we want to discuss here, that is called a slash b. A slash b. A slash b says whatever the element which can contain in the a which not include in the b. So 3, 4 which is included in the b, but 1, 2 is not included. So a slash b is contained 1, 2. So a slash b, it is nothing but the difference a minus b. Those elements which are not, which are in a and b both, we can exclude. Those elements which are in a but not in b, we can take as a slash b. Similarly, suppose we can find the b slash a. What is the b slash a? Those elements which can contain in b but not contain in a. So that is 3, 4, both are there. So 5, 6, 7 is contained in b but not contained in a. Similarly, we can find a slash c. A slash c, those elements which can contain in a but not contain in c. So a slash c, we can just find 1, 2, 3, 4, because 1, 2, 3, 4 consists here 6, 7, 8, 9. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So these are the things we have to overcome. What is the a slash b and b slash a? Now, next point which we want to discuss here, that is the another problem. Can write in a mathematical notation the difference between the a slash b, x such that x is a member of a but x is not a member of b. That is called the a slash b. If suppose we can find b slash a, you can write x such that X is a member of A, comma X is not a member of A. So now A slash B, it is written in the form of Venn diagram. We can write it is a A, it is a B, and A slash B, it is only that shaded line, it is indicate for the A slash B. Now we want to find the B slash A. Similarly, we can write AB is a universal, and this shaded line, it is indicate for the B slash A. So that is the way in which you can find the difference. Now the another point which we want to discuss, that is called symmetric difference. So symmetric difference we can generally treat it as a AX or B. AX or B, it is indicate for symmetric difference. So what is the symmetric difference? The A X or B equal to A union B slash A intersection B, or we can write A X or B equal to A slash B union B slash A. So that's the formula in which we can find out the symmetric difference. So this is the way in which we can find the symmetric difference. So now, what is the properties of the symmetric difference? So the properties of symmetric difference, the first properties we can use, that is called the associative second commutative, and third it is called distributive. So these three properties which can incorporate in the case of symmetric difference. So in symmetric difference we can just treat it, this is a set, this is a B, and this symbols, and it is, we can call as a universal set, it is called as a AX or B of shaded line. This is a set A, it is a set B. So that is the difference in between the symmetric difference. Now the another problem which we want to discuss, that is, next is the set theory identities. So the identities, or we can say law of algebra, we can incorporate it in the case of propositional and predicate logic. Same here we can use in the case of set theory. First is the identity law, A intersection union equal to A, and A union phi equal to A. This is called as identity law. Now domination law is A union universal equal to U union and A intersection phi equal to A. Third is the idempotent law, A union A equal to A intersection A equal to A. Next is the, we can discuss about the commutative law, associative law, and distributive law. So commutative law, we can say A union B equal to B union A, or A intersection B equal to B intersection A. Similarly, we can use the distributive law, associative law, A union B union C equal to A union B union C, distributive law, A union B intersection C equal to A union B. So it is like that, A union B intersection C, which is equal to A union B, then now intersection A union C. So similarly, we can also perform the operation on the different type of operation, we can also incorporate in the propositional logics. And so next is the De Morgan law. And De Morgan law, we can know A union B bar equal to A bar intersection B bar, and A intersection B ka bar equal to A bar union B bar. So these are the, we can also use to solve the problem of the based on the set theory. So certain expression is given and we can compare that equation, if expression is equally matched or not, based on the law of identities. So So now we can take a De Morgan theorem proof, that is A union B complement equal to A bar intersection B bar. We can also write this form A union B ka C equal to A to the power C, A complement intersection B to the power C. So that can be proved with the two methods, one with the help of Venn diagram, another with the help of, we can solve with the help of laws of identities. So here we can use A union B to the power C. We can start from the left hand side, that is A union B to the power C is a subset of A to the power C intersection B to the power C. So now, if suppose we can say X is a member of A union B to the power C. So X is not a member of A union B. So X is not a member of A union B, that means X is not a member of A, comma, X is not a member of B. But X is a member of A to the power C, X is a member of B to the power C. Hence, we can say X is a member of A to the power C intersection B to the power C. So now, A to the power C intersection B to the power C is subset of A union B to the power C. Now, we can take X is a member of A to the power C intersection B to the power C. Now, X is a member of A to the power C. X is not a member of A. X is a member of B to the power C. X is not a member of B. So now, hence we can say X is not a member of A union B. So X is a member of A union B to the power C. So here we can say A union B to the power C equal to A to the power C intersection B to the power C. So now we can prove based on the this is the theorem which we call as a De Morgan theorem. So now next is the mutually exclusive and exhaustive sets. So we say that a group of sets is exhaustive of another set if their union is equal to the that set. That is, if A union B equal to C, we say that A and B are exhaustive with respect to the C. So when we can say it's an exhaustive set, when the union of the two set A union B, which is equal to the some another set, which is called as a exhaustive sets. So we say that two sets A and B are mutually exclusive if A intersection B equal to none. It is also called as a disjoint, and the set have no element in the common. So it is called as a exclusive set. So now next is we can concept about the duality. So the duality concept is that suppose it is the one equation is given, E equation, and we can say in that E equation we can use universal intersection empty set and universal. Now it can be replaced with the E dash equation, union by intersection, intersection by union, and phi by universal and universal by phi. So that type of it is called, the concept is called as a duality concept. So it is a E is a equation in which we can use this term. That term will be converted into the all the symbol to the union with intersection, intersection with union, phi with universal, and universal with phi is called as a duality of the equation. So now we can take one example, a universal union A, universal union A, union B intersection A. So now that equation is given, universal, it is union A, union B intersection of A which is equal to E. That is the equation E. Now we can find it as equation of the duality equation, universal convert into the phi. It is union, it is the intersection A. Now union convert with the intersection and B, intersection convert to union which is equal to A. So that is the duality of the equation. Now, next is the ordered set. It is a sequence of some relevance which is called as an ordered set. And the ordered pair, we can say, the arrange the number of elements in some order. Suppose we can say A comma B, that is the element we can first occurrence of A, then occurrence of B, and now the another set of element which can contain B comma A, that is first occurrence of B, then occurrence of A. So that is called as an ordered pair. So now sets are extensively used to counting problem for which we need to find the size of the set. So basically in the counting problem we can use the some rule, product rules, and the another things we can use the probabilistic counting and distributive counting. In that case we can use the concept of counting problems. So if there are exactly n distinct element in a set S with n non-negative integer, so we say that the S is a set which is a finite set, and the cardinality of the S is nothing but the n. So mod of S equal to n. A set that is not finite, which is called as a infinite set. So now we can one by one describe what is a finite set, what is a countable infinite set, what is an uncountable infinite set. So a set which is called a finite, if there is a one-to-one correspondence between the element in the set and the same set n, where n is the set of natural number, and it is called as a numerable set. We can just take an example in which we can more clarify. That is a set of natural number 1, 2, 3 and so on, and we can take the even number, set of even number. So 1 is 1 to 1 corresponding with 2, 2 is 1 to 1 corresponding with second even number, 3 is 1 to 1 corresponding with 6, next 4, 1 to 1 corresponding with 8 and so on. So that is called as a finite set. So countable infinite, it is the also, it is the same set. We can take the value up to 4, not set of natural number. If suppose the number is going to be n, it is called as a countable infinite. It is a finite. We can take the 4 number 1, 2, 3, 4, and there is a 4 even number 2, 4, 6, 8. It is called 1 to 1 correspondent. Now the same thing is countable infinite. If there is a 1 to 1 correspondent between the element in the set and element in n. Now if suppose we can take n number of element, it is called as a countable infinite set. Uncountable set, a set which is not countable, it's infinite, is called uncountable infinite or non-denumerable sets or uncountable sets. So there is a three type of set which we can discuss: finite, countable infinite and uncountable sets. So here the example we can take, let's B is a set X such that X is less than equal to 100 and X is a prime. The cardinality of the B, if we want to find the prime number between the which is less than equal to 100, that is total 25, because there is 25 prime less than or equal to 100. So the cardinality of the empty set is always 0. So cardinality of phi equal to 0, and that we have to already discuss, that is set of natural number, set of integer, set of rational number, set of real number are all on the infinite. So now we can come to the power set. The power set of set S denoted by the P of S is set of all subsets of S. So power set we can generally find, it is 2 to the power S, or we can find 2 to the power mod n. 2 to the power mod n, it is called the power set. In that case, we can take the element is, any three element we can take is set of A, which can contain A, B, C. Now total number of element we can consider as 2 to the power 3, that is 8. So in that eight element, first we can consider of the null set, then we can take this single element A, then single element B, then C. Then we can take all the pair in between the A, B, C. So here we can take A comma B, now take B comma C, now take C comma A. So here, now next one is A comma B comma C. So total 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So here, we can just find the power set, which is nothing but 2 to the power 3, because this consists of in a set 3 elements. The total number of 2 to the power 3 is 8 elements. So now, let's say another example here take us, the A comma B and another element is the C. In which case, we can also find the power set in such a way that first we can consist the empty set, then we can contain A comma B, then we can contain C and A, B, C. So, now the main difference between what is the power set of null and what is the power set of empty set and what is the power set of the empty set, we can consider only singleton element, that is called the phi. But what is the power set of this set? We can take the what is the power set of this one. In curly braces we can write the phi. It can consist of one is the phi, another is the curly braces of phi. So if suppose there is n element, so we can generate 2 to the power n number of elements of the in the power set. So that is the description we can mention in the Roshan at page number 115. The power set is a fundamental combinatorial object useful when considering all possible combination of element of the set. So as we can told, the power set is nothing but 2 to the power n. So S is a set such that mod of S equal to n, then P of S equal to nothing but 2 to the power n. So now, we can come to the next point, the considered ordered collection of the objects. So, the ordered n tuples we can take a1, a2 up to an is the ordered collection with element ai being ith element from the I equal to 1, 2, 3 up to n. As we can told earlier, what is the difference between the ordered set and ordered pair? Ordered set means there is some sequence, that is called the ordered set. The relevance or ordered pair, we can say the ordered pair in which we can say there is some sequence like that. We can say A is occur before B, and now another element B can be occur before the A. That is called the ordered pair, that is in sequence in which first occurrence of A, here first occurrence of B. So here in the case ordered n tuples, the ordered collection of the element A being in ith element of 1 to n, and two ordered n tuples, that is first is the a1 a2 an and b1 b2 bn are equal if I equal to 1 to n. And we can say if suppose ai contain the value a1 a2 a3 and so on, and bi contain the value b1 b2 up to b3, so both ai equal to b of I. So it is called as a ordered pair. So if A and B are two sets, so the Cartesian product of A and B, we can denote it by the A cross P. It's a set of all ordered pair A comma B. A is a member of A and B is a member of B. So here we can say A cross B equal to A comma B such that A is a member of A and A is a member of B. So that mathematical definition you should know about the Cartesian product A cross B. So it can also consist of A is a member of A and we can consist A is a member of B. So both elements should be present in the pair of A comma B. So product is known as cross product. Now one important thing you have to remember, A cross B not equal to B cross A. In a Cartesian product, A cross B must not be equal to B cross A. So we can go to the one example in which we can more clarify about how the cross product should be worked.